Nel Tarleton.
Nel Tarleton. Now here's a story for you on Nel Tarleton. On the 20th of August, a funeral took place in our family of my dad's cousin, Joey Brown. Now, Nel Tarleton was the first recipient of the pension when you win a Lonsdale belt outright. But he didn't live very long to receive it. He won two Lonsdale belts outright. The last time was the last time he defended his title was when he beat Al Phillips at Bellevue, Manchester Kings Hall. That was his last fight. Nel Tarleton was a brilliant boxer, left-handed boxer, and I'll put it this way, he was a friend of my father actually. Now, the relation of my dad's cousin, Joey Brown, who died, was in the Air Force during the war. Before that he was in the Home Guard, and actually, though Joey Brown went to the grammar school, it was over here, and spent a lot of time in Liverpool when he was a boy, getting on the train, because his dad was a signalman. He used to get on there, they used to put him in the guard van. He spent a lot of time going over to Woodside in Birkenhead, then over to the docks, and he learned how to be a linguist. You might say, well, it's got to do with boxing. But Joey Brown was very useful as a boxer, though he never boxed, he sparred and everything like this. And Nel Tarleton, during the war, was in the RAF. And he was going down the camps, giving exhibitions, naturally, with other boxers. And this day something had happened and went wrong, and either the person had taken Nel. But however, during Nel Tarleton was due at this camp where Joey Brown was, and of course Nel spotted him. Well, he knew him through my father and going to the boxing and things like that. And the next thing you knew, Nel Tarleton said, there's a man here, he said, that can will definitely go in with me. And Joey had never told anybody he'd ever sparred or boxed or trained or anything, but this was typical of Joe. Anyhow, actually, he actually gave an exhibition, Joey Brown gave an exhibition with the great Nel Tarleton. Afterwards, they wanted Joey to box for their camp team, but Joe Brown was the sort of man, and he said, there's a bigger fight taking place. And that was Joe Brown. Joe Brown was a very, very quiet man. He was a navigator. He got decorated before he joined the RAF. He was in, now you're in Chester now, the Rudees over there, the Western Command, which is now part of the University, is over there. That was the headquarters of the Western Command. Satan Campus, it was a military place. The Germans dropped paratroopers. Joe Brown caught them. He was with the people who caught them. When he joined the RAF, this is a story that goes, and his sons, I can give you the thing and they will tell you, that Joe never told them, and you have to find out off me, and different things, what happened. And Joe actually, when he put his uniform on for the first time, put this ribbon on, and straight away they thought somebody was taking the mech, and he was in the guardhouse. Then he come out, he had permission to use it. But Joe also got decorated by this country and by the Netherlands, because he got shot down over in the Netherlands. And what happened was this, that with him going round the docks, Joe Brown could speak Spanish, German, French before he joined. Well, next thing, he was in Dutch resistance, and he got a citation. He got a medal off the Dutch residents as well. He had a lot to do with Roger Needham, but he was a wonderful man. And my earliest recollection of him was with, I used to call him Uncle Joe, and was Auntie Monica, his wife, was when he was on leave, wounded leave. I think he got back to this country after the Netherlands. There was a picture house in Saltney, in a place of all the places called Cable Street, Coronation Street, and it was called the Palace Cinema. And they took me there when they were caught. Now I could have only been 4 at the most. And my father told a story of when his mother in Sunday on church, and Joe was on leave, and he kissed his mother and gave her a posy. And a lot of people thought he was a Nancy boy. And when my father was going to take umbrage, Joe said, "Tom, leave it. They don't know what they do. They don't know." That's the sort of man he was. He was a wonderful man. And he was the sort of man, it didn't matter a belief of people who knew him. Like my uncle Ronnie told me, my dad's brother. It doesn't matter what sport he took part in, he was good at. Football, he played football for the school, the schoolboys and things like that. But he was so quiet, such a gentleman. You mentioned about Nel Tarleton, but I've talked about my Uncle Joe. But actually, it was a lad from Chester who fought Nel Tarleton by the name of Jimmy Walsh. Jimmy dropped him in the first round. And Fred Tilson was there. And he said after that, like, Nel just outboxed him. And Jimmy Walsh could box. And yet, Jimmy Walsh, he beat Ernie Roderick in a catchweight. Now this is what we're going to talk about over weight making as well. Jimmy Walsh was a lightweight. The bout with Ernie Roderick was made at 10-2, I believe. Now Walsh won that fight handily. Walsh had a hell of a job. He's 5'10" in height to make the lightweight limit. He must have gone through torture to make that limit. He beat Ted Kidberg for the title. He defended it against Harry Misler but lost it to Dave Crowley. Well, I heard of people who knew that he hardly ate anything from the week before Crowley had anything. And, you know, I'll tell you this straight, we've got the same thing today, but there was no light welterweight in those days. So if you look at it realistically, if he fought around the 10 stone mark when he fought Roderick, he'd have been an ideal light welter today. But then again, would he? Because you light welters today, they're going in at the middleweight limit. Now, this is where you can't compare what's classed as a middleweight today. What's classed as a middleweight yesterday or yesteryear. You know, it's just one of those things.
No, I'd like to hear more about the weight meeting.
What
I'd like to know, Tom, when boxers boil down to make a weight, thinking that they'll be bigger and stronger on fight night, but to get to do that process, they have to almost kill themselves. Some of them are fainting on the scales, and then they go and eat a load of crap, get filled up, and on night they're going to be like not right.
Yeah.
So why not just be strong and box at a higher weight? What's your opinion on all the weight?
I'll be honest with you now. I don't agree. I never did agree with this. It was supposed to be a 24-hour weigh-in before the fights. Now you're talking about a 36-hour weigh, aren't you? Because the weigh-in's around about 12 o'clock in the day. By the time you get in the ring, your top liner can be 36 hours, isn't it? So you put that much weight on. Now what I'm saying to you, it's going to take effect somewhere along the line. Years ago, I mentioned Jimmy Walsh. He never reached 65. How many boxers in those days, Joe Gans, the great Joe Gans, the middle, the lightweight champion, people like that, boiled themselves down to make the weight. Now, I'll be quite honest with you, some of them, because, like Joe Gans, because he was coloured and other people, because they weren't fashionable, had to make less than the weight than what they should have done. Say that it's just the same as what some of them been doing today, like Canelo when he wanted that fella to fight a certain weight, and Mayweather the same. Now what I'm saying, if 11 stone 6 is the weight, it's not 11 stone 2. Why should a man who's fighting for the 11 stone 6 title have to fight for after getting an 11 stone 2? Now I'll tell you for why. Because of one thing, it suits the promoters, and another thing is this, they're gaining an advantage. One of the biggest advocates in this country for the weigh-in 24 hours before, in my opinion, was Mickey Duff, because he had two boxers at that particular time in his stable. The lad from Telford.
Richie Woodall.
Woodall. And the lad, Bob McCracken. One was a light middle, boxing the light middle at that time, and the other as a middle, right? They were big boys at that, right? Both fought for world titles, but I'll tell you this straight now. Must have been purgatory for them to get down to that weight and box that night. Now this is what I'm trying to say about the weight making. Sugar A. Robinson, 11 stone 6, right? You got weighed in a day, you fought that night, right? You couldn't put that much on, could you? Right? Now then, what would some of these light middleweights, or light welterweights, go in the ring at? They're weighing in 36 hours before, they're getting in the ring, they'll be 11 and a half stone. What chance would they have with the likes of Sugar Ray? Ask yourself a question. It's what you weigh on the fight, that's what you are. Now, what I'm saying to you is this, that, you know, when you weigh up, what you say is, you know, look at what they've gone through to make that weight and how they've put that on. They've gone through hell to make that weight. Now, I know, now I'm 79 next month, and I know this, that I can't take the knocks that like I used to. Now then, just like the people that had to make weights when there was a weigh-in at the time, fight on the boxing that night, they make the weigh-in at 2 o'clock in the morning, at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. What's going to happen to these people that's took over the stone off, and sometimes more, to make that weight? And then they've put it back on. It's not natural, is it? I think there's going to be a payback time sometime. Now, you heard me talk about Jake LaMotta before. Jake won the Golden Gloves at a light middle, as a light heavyweight. Now, how he got down to middleweight, it must have near killed him. He's one hard man, I mean. He was 90-odd years of age when I met him. And he, for all the punishments and all the fights he had his faculties about him. Now, it just shows you what a remarkable man he was. But this weight making like it is, I would rather it see, look, are they trying to gain an advantage by getting down to this weight, hoping then it can, you know, is it worth it playing with your health that way? I mean, I can be honest with you now, I can eat what I want and never put weight on. I've been fortunate. But, I mean, I've got to be honest with you, like, I've actually, with the cancer, I actually lost a bit of weight. And I've had to have my suits taken in. Lucky enough, I've got a good tailor. But, I mean, I go there and I've had to have a few suits taken in because they seem to be hanging on me, you know. And, well, when I go to a boxing show, I want to look the part. I mean, you know, this is what I'm saying, like, that you can't take the knocks like you used to. Like, I've got over the cancer. I mean, I afford to drink. I mean, a lot of people said that helped. It's helping people when I've spoke about it. Well, just the same with the cancer. I mean, if you've boxed, it helps you in life. The other week I saw a friend of mine. This man was a happy-go-lucky character. He was worried to death. He said, Tommy, he said, you've had this. He said, I've got to go, I've got prostate cancer. I said, listen, look at it this way. It's only another opponent. I said, that's the way you've got to look at it. I said, another thing is this. I said, his wife went and got a coffee and I said, now listen, pull yourself together. I'll be honest with you now. Boxing helps you in life. When I was diagnosed with cancer, it nearly broke my wife. Now, I couldn't afford to let my wife see me being worried. I said to her, I said, look, it's nothing, it's only another opponent. And I went to the hospital, I said this. The man come to me and everything, I said, now look, I can do nothing about this, but you can. I said, just so I had a second in the corner when I was boxing and things was going wrong, he could tell me where I was going wrong. I said, so you're my second. I said, I can do nothing about it, but you can. I said, I've got to give you 110%. You do what you've got to do, and I've got to give you 110%. And he looked at me. He said, you know, I said, yes. Now, when I went to Clatterbridge, I'm going to be honest with you. I fell asleep when I was having the scan. The nurse come out and said to me, what sort of a man are you married to? She said, he fell asleep there, she snored. And she said, well, he is a bit laid back. I wasn't worried. Right. But I saw people there. They'd give up before he went and infected the families. You could see the poor wives and children. Look, it doesn't matter what it is, you can't show it. It's like this. I learned a lot off a man. He brought 6 kids up. He couldn't pay everything in one go. And the people would come round and knock for the door or something like that. And whenever he was in the muck, he used to sing. It was an old song. I'll tell you the song of the Nancy Lee, the bravest ship that went to sea. The bravest man was Captain Brown because he played the ukulele when the ship went down. Some went here, some went there. And the kids would be singing it with him. And I'll tell you this straight, I learnt a lot off that man. And I'll tell you what I learnt. If you're in this shit, enjoy it because you're in it until you get out of it. I was up in court one day. He said, this is no laughing matter. The barrister. I said, what do you mean no laughing matter? I said, listen, my old son, I said, the way I was brought up, I said, if you're in the, I said, if you're in the proverbial, you stay in the proverbial. No use letting it get you down. I said, you enjoy it while you're at it. And you know what? You couldn't see, you couldn't handle it. It's just the same as this Brexit now. I mean, I feel sorry for these politicians. Half of them's got no red blood in the veins, have they? I mean, they walk through, as soon as they get into Westminster, they get the old politician's disease, Archimedes without the principle. In other words, the red blood leaves the veins. I mean, what would you say to that plonky, that piss artist in from Luxembourg? Son, sit down and behave yourself. If it wasn't for us and the Commonwealth, you'd still be under the German jackboot, don't forget it. And that is what they need to be told. But, oh, you can't say that today. Why not? What's stopping you? I'll tell you what's stopping you. You might upset one or two people. I'll tell you straight. If you go through life like that, I reckon in my life, through being as I am, I've had less trouble than a lot of people. Because I'll tell you one thing, when you sit down, when I had the row over the ground with the council, I wouldn't sit down with them once the blue went up. It was me and them then. You're looking at the last man standing. I'll tell you this right, you don't sit down with them. Because all they want to sit down with you for is to talk you around. They'll still stab you in the back. No, it's you and it's them. After the fight's over, that's all right. It's just the same being in the ring. Get stuck in, have your fight. Shake hands with the man after, yeah. But while you're not in there, you're not going to give him a hug and a kiss, are you? No.
You knew what you was doing in there. I think it was your daughter who was up in there and you spoke.
Oh! What happened, Anne-Marie was at the tribunal. Now, Anne-Marie worked for Allied Carpets. And, of course, the firm went. She lost her flats, the lot. She was very depressed. And she only had the doctor with depression. After 13 or weeks or something, they called her in. She went there and they said she'd, they had the, said she could work again. Well, she couldn't, so she appealed. And I went there, and what happened was this, that during, as soon as he got there at 11 o'clock in the morning, we should have been in 11, they asked if we got this, got that, and got the other. And I turned around and said, look, it's a good job. I said that, this was at the tribunal, because the people who's going to help her never helped her. So I said, I go with her. And, well, the thing that happened was this, that when we went there, I've got this, I said, excuse me, I said, not surprising they're getting shot to rags in Afghanistan. I said, if you're sending them in there without any weapons, like, you know. I said, we'll be putting an appeal against this before we kick off, the way it's going on. And now she went back in, and he gets in at 20 past 11. But it kicks off, and before, when it kicked off, it started. I said, now before anybody starts, I said, I hope everybody's lily white. I said, and faithful to their partners, I said, because this is a fight. And he looked at me. The chairman of the tribunal, he looked at me, I said, yeah. And the next thing, I said, for a start, and he started, I said, Anne-Marie's doctor said, she's not fit. And where? This other fellow said, well, you've got a medical thing, thing here that says she is. I said, look, I said, from one, I said, he said, I'm a doctor. I said, oh, yes. I said, from, I'm going to tell you something. I said, I'm a bricklayer. I said, and they say about a bricklayer, if he's a bit rough, it's a good job a plaster follows him. I said, and I'm telling you, it's a good job an undertaker follows some out of your profession. I said, because you read about it every week in the paper. But you know what? He said, I'm a good doctor. I said, I don't know that. I mean, the next thing, you could see how it was going. They wasn't used to this sort of questioning because the ruling got overturned and Anne-Marie, now she's working, she's back in work, now like part-time, but I mean, she won the appeal. It was just the same, you know, that like when that barrister said he didn't like the way I was looking at him, you know. And then I said, excuse me, you know, like when he said, do you know you're talking to? And I turned around and I said to the judge, I said, look, I said, there's a fella that he doesn't know who he is, I expect me to know. And he looked like, he said, I'm a barrister, I said, well, I'm a bricklayer. I said, I won't be a better bricklayer than you are a barrister. I said, because I've never advertised for work. I said, you get your job out of chambers, you might be bottom of the heap. Well, the judge gave a bit of thing. And all my mates, I was representing me, you know, I was talking up with my mate, like, he said, as he was walking out, we adjourned it, because he said somebody was afraid. All Robbie's mates were shouting, what's my name? Like Muhammad Ali, some pantomime that was. But, you know, it's things like that, you know. Talking soft. I mean, what makes it any difference because they're a barrister and me a bricklayer? You know, This is the trouble. Half of them, I'm not just talking about barristers, but your politicians. What experience they've had in life. I mean, you look at the people that helped to mold my character. The likes of Joe Connor took me to court to show me how to conduct myself in court. You'd have thought he was running it. Arnhem Joe. Harry Evans. Gordon Evans. Fred Tilston. Fred Pickering. Fred Pickering was like the Brian Hughes. Like Brian Hughes. I'll tell you straight now, it was only, I look at it this way, Lance Williams, when he was talking about Brian Hughes, he was in America, and he said, what am I doing here? The best trainer I've ever had's back in home in England. And I'll tell you one thing, it was only when I went, after the old club shut down, went elsewhere, I realised what I owed Fred Pickering, and that crowd, you know, that's the way you look at it.